Yes, thank you. The Christmas tree is up out there, and what I invite you to do is to, don't drop it on the floor, but get a little tag off the Christmas tree. It gives you the gender and age of some child. I would encourage you to bring your children to the Christmas tree and pick a child to pray for that child and his or her family for their good Christmas. Now, this church has participated in a gifting event for Franklin Gateway Needy Families for 11 years now. This is our 11th year. And yes, praise the Lord. The families on Franklin Gateway now remember us, and they're grateful. They tell me that all the time. Last year, people started hearing about it, and our enrollment doubled. We had 100 on our that we generally served. Last year, it got to 200, and you came through. This year, we're being really careful about our invitations to enrollment, getting them vetted well. We are expecting 200, but we're going to keep it at 200. But I need your prayers for these families first. If you'd like to take the card and get a gift for that child now, that's fine. We will have wish lists later that you can purchase by. The gifts are due here by the Christmas tree on the Sabbath after Thanksgiving. So you do have Black Friday to shop if you want to. Or you can make a donation in the tithe envelope for Franklin Gateway, and we'll go out and shop for you. But the miracle to me is to watch these families be so grateful for not only this Christmas event where, yes, they get to hear Bible stories and do Bible activities while they're waiting for their gifts, but also for the ways that you help them throughout the year. Thank you.
It's wonderful that we can work in our community. While we're talking about that, actually we have two young gentlemen that are actually going to pass out these cards, their Live Well cards. Don't lose them. They're actually a key point in the sermon today. So Matt will address that. So hang on to those and keep them in a safe place during the sermon. And while we're actually talking about change, you have the perfect opportunity now to get your photos taken for the directory. We like to remember people. And so I'm sure they're getting done in room 104, I believe. And after church, you can do it this week and next week. So it's always good to be connected. And if you are real nice to Michael Fushka, who's taking the pictures, he may be able to do a little Photoshop for you, make you look a little younger. You never know what he can do. So he does magic with the camera. Okay. Lastly, I believe we have Matt is going to. We've got some exciting things happening today. We're having a baptism. And Matt wants to introduce our new baptismal candidates. Thanks, Matt.
I'm going to invite Dylan. That's cool that you guys color coordinated. It's well done. Way to think ahead. Well, I don't know what my problem was. A lot of you are here for Delasia, whether you're fellow students or just Delasia's been a part of our church for a while. Maybe it's youth, young adult. I know Morgan came all the way home from college to be a part of this, so that's really cool. Ben, he's a young dude that's been here for a bit. Actually, Ben's story is kind of cool. I think it was because we had an altar call one day, and I think you came up. Either way, you wrote to me on a card that said you wanted to be baptized. This was probably, I don't know, almost a year ago. You don't remember this, do you? I remember it. I still have the card. Ben has been through our fundamentals class as he's wanted to know the big picture of who God is, and his family's here. There's going to be some songs here in a minute, too. Delasia, I think it's so cool when you have collegians that get baptized, and not that it's bad when you're young, but it's different when you're a little bit older, and Delasia's been on a journey with Jesus, too, and you're in fundamentals right now. We've gone through that, and I've had some good conversations with her. Both of these young people are excited about their baptisms today. And so, Ben, I'm going to put you on the spot first, man. You know this is coming. You can hold this microphone. And here's the question I'm going to ask you. Ben, why are you excited? Or tell us why you're excited about being baptized today.
I just want to get as close as I can to God.
I mean, that's pretty simple. That's all you need. Well done, sir. Thank you, thank you. Delasia, I know you're a little nervous up front, but that's okay. You sing here all the time. Tell us why you're excited about being baptized today.
I found like a true friend in God, somebody I can count on, somebody I can trust. So I'm very excited and ready to just commit my life to Him and go on a spiritual journey.
It's awesome. Yeah. Very, very, very nice. We've got some presents for you all. This is a gift from our church to help you on your spiritual journey. This is yours, and this is yours, Ben. And how many of you, pending their baptism, would like to say, welcome to the Marietta Seventh-day Adventist Church? There's your church family, guys. Great. We'll see you here in just a few moments.
Back minute to keep you in the loop so you can find out what happened during the week.
All right, boys and girls, it's time for your story. So if you can come on up here and get some offering along the way, that will benefit our school. Wow, where is everybody today? Did they go outside in the beautiful weather? So today I'm going to tell you a story, but I'm going to have an experiment for you as well, okay? There were two friends, Thomas and Jim. And Thomas had never been to Jim's house. And so he said, come over to my house. I want you to visit. And so Thomas went to Jim's house, and he lived out in the country. Lots of trees and a big creek. And Thomas was looking around saying, wow, I've never seen this, all this nature. And Jim says, shh, listen. And Thomas says, what? Listen. Gobble, 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 gobble. What is that? Turkeys, wild turkeys. You have wild turkeys out here? Yes. We also have deer. And if you're real quiet, you'll hear them walking on the leaves and on the branches. And if you look over here by the creek, there's little paw prints of deer or raccoons. And then at nighttime, Jim took Thomas out, and the sky was just beautiful, lots of stars. And then he says, shh, listen. Woo, woo, an owl. Oh, you're very smart. Well, Thomas said, Jim, now you need to come to my house. So he said, okay. So Jim went to Thomas's house. He looked around. Zoom, 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 zoom. Ooh, there's a lot of cars around here, and lights blinking, and a lot of noise from construction. And he said, you know what, Jim? There's not very much nature here. But we have a park. Would you like to go to the park? So he took him to the park, and there was kids playing, and dogs were over here. They were playing, too. People were having a picnic. And then he said, Jim, you can't hear nature here. And Jim says, shh, listen. He heard something. What is it? It's a woodpecker right over there in that tree. No way. There's no woodpeckers here. Yes, there's a woodpecker. And if you listen really carefully, over there, there's a squirrel. I can hear him crawling up the tree or running around in the leaves with trying to collect nuts. And Thomas said, no, I cannot hear that. And Jim said, you can recognize that which you are familiar with. Well, what does that mean? If you spend time in nature or with something or someone, you're going to recognize it. So right now I'm going to have you guys listen to something, and you're not going to be able to see it, but let's see if you can hear it. So listen very carefully. Shh, listen. What is it? What is that sound? What is it? Keys. How do you know about keys? Do you drive? No? Okay. It sounds like keys. Oh, you've been around them. Okay, here's another sound. Listen very carefully. A phone. Okay. How do you know about a phone? Do you have a phone?
My mommy does, and I heard it.
Oh. Okay, let's hear another sound. Anthony. A jacket. Oh, a zipper. Where do you have zippers on? Jackets? Boots? Your pants? Okay, here's another one. Now, this one's a really tough one, so listen carefully. See if you can hear this one. What is it? What? A car engine? No. What do you think it is? A cow? No. What do you think it is? What? Thunder? Okay, listen one more time. Those are scissors. They're kind of hard to tell, huh? Because you're not supposed to be playing with scissors, right? Okay, one more. This one's a really hard one. And this one is one that my son, when he was little, I heard this sound and I thought, I don't know what that sound is. And then I realized it. So listen really carefully. What do you think it is? A spoon tapping on something. What? A bowl. Close. Dishes? Special dishes. What kind of dishes? Now your mom and dad might have them, but I know your grandma has this. What is it? Bell? No, it's a special dish that comes out maybe at Christmas. It's called china. Do you know what china is? Oh, okay. You're not allowed around those, but I heard my kids just tink, 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 and I thought, whoa, that's my china. Be careful because it's breakable. Well, here's the thing. Jim told Thomas, you will recognize what you are familiar with. And so listen very carefully to the sound. Jim put his hand in his pocket and he pulled something out and he dropped it on the sidewalk. So listen real carefully to what it is. Ready? Quarters, money. How do you know about money? You guys aren't working yet. You have money? Oh. Well, 20 people turned around at the park because they recognized money. Well, you know what, boys and girls? Jesus has a little passage in scripture that says this. I'm a good shepherd, and you all are the sheep. Now, you guys as sheep, you get lost. You actually wander away. You're afraid of those wolves. And you know what? They hear my voice because I'm a good shepherd. But how do we hear Jesus' voice when he's in heaven? We have to do what? So you talk to Jesus. What else? How else can we hear Jesus' voice? You're not afraid of wolves? That's good. What else can we do to listen to Jesus' voice? We read the Bible, right? And listen to the stories. And how do you know it's Jesus' voice? So if mom and dad says, Emily, Caffrey, time to go to bed. No, I don't want to go to bed now. No. And then Jesus gives you a little thought. And what does he say? I think you need to obey mom and dad. Is that the voice of Jesus? Yes. And what about if you have a really special toy at home and you want to take it to school, but it's just mine, 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 just mine. And somebody says, but I want to play with your toy. And suddenly you have a thought that comes to your mind that says, wouldn't you want someone to share that with you? Right? That's the voice of Jesus. So this week, I want for all of us to take a little bit more time with Jesus so that we can recognize his voice, okay? Who would like to pray today?
Dear God, help all the people that are sick. Thank you for this good day. Thank you that we have a good church and good food. Thank you that we have good parents and good friends. Amen.
All right, you can go back to your seats now.
Over, he returned to France and resumed his life as a farmer of many estates. In 1783, the harvest was a terrible one, and there were many who suffered as a result. Lafayette's farms were unaffected by the devastating crop failures. One of his workers offered what seemed to be good advice to Lafayette. The bad harvest had raised the price of wheat. This is the time to sell. After thinking about the hungry peasants in the surrounding villages, Lafayette disagreed and said, no, this is the time to give. We're blessed and we have the opportunity to give, and the Lord takes care of us. Would the deacons please stand? Lord, we thank you so much for the blessings that you provide. Many of them we don't even notice as we go by day to day in the busy rush of things. We thank you for the time to give back so that this church can be a light in this community. Amen. Thank you.
It's an honor to be singing for him on his baptism. We're going to sing, Ben, one of your favorite songs. You can sing from there, okay? You can help us.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Bunch here that are excited. They're singing for you too. And up in heaven, the Lord's smiling at you too. I can just see Jesus on the throne, smiling. There's my boy, Ben. Ben, because you love Jesus and because he loved you first, it's an honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
It's who you are.
It's cool. I see your mom and your brother out there supporting you. You got a whole row of peers here smiling, waving, making faces at you probably. That's okay too. I know God's in heaven excited as well. He's been looking forward to this day for a long time, just like you have. What a journey you have been on and will continue to be on. Delasia, because Jesus loves you and because you love him back, it's an honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I know that you're so excited now as you've watched Ben and Delasia give their lives to you through baptism. And God, I'd be remiss if I didn't open this as an opportunity for those that are here to follow in your footsteps and theirs too. So God, in the middle of this prayer, I'm going to invite those that want to be baptized to raise their hands right now. Yes. 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 Amen. Heavenly Father, we're just praising you for being God that rejoices with us through this. And God, we love you and we can't wait to see you in Jesus' name.
Nothing more special than a Sabbath that includes baptisms. And our next song is entitled, I Give Myself Away. And the lyrics read, my life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself to you. And it's my prayer that that is what we desire too. And so please join us as we sing our next song, I Give Myself Away.
My life is not my own. Jesus, you have given us freedom. I'm no longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. I'm dressed in your royalty.
Before the throne of God. Heavenly Father, we come into your presence with thanksgiving and praise on our lips. Today was a high day, Lord. Baptisms, people deciding to follow you. But we also come into your presence, Lord, with heavy hearts. As we watch on the news the devastation that has occurred in Florida, it's a reminder, Lord, that we can build things up here on earth, but this is not our home. And so I ask, Father, that you will help us to have courage to pick up lives where things are broken or torn apart. Because you are the one who gives us courage and hope. And I pray for your hand to be upon your people, but also this world. I know you are looking down and just waiting for the day when you can take us back home. Because this is not our home, and you have something so much better and so much more special to be in your presence, where there's no tears, there's no pain, there's no sickness. And there's no broken dreams. Lord, I just pray for a special blessing for everyone that's here today. You know the cries of our heart. And I just pray that you also open our ears to recognize your voice and your leading in our lives. Because you are a good, good Father. Someone who never leaves us nor forsakes us. Someone who never abandons us, and someone who has good things in store for us. And so I just pray that you will breathe upon each person today and breathe upon Pastor Matt as he gives us your word. May it touch our lives, Lord, in a way that we can leave here changed because we've been in the presence of the Almighty God, who is the lover of our soul and our Savior. Amen.
Last Sabbath, for those of you that were at the church retreat, you know it was a little bit warm. In fact, those that you didn't come were might have been smart last week. Having worship in your home, I'm sure you prayed a lot, whatever. Maybe you slept in. Up in Michigan when I was at seminary, the church was called Pioneer Memorial Church. And sometimes when people would skip church, they would say, I'm going to PMC Church, Pillow Mattress Comforter Church. So I don't know if that was you last week, but that might have been a wise decision. It was too hot. Next year, we've already planned it to be a little later in the year, so it'll be cooler. Hey, listen, the next 3 weeks are going to be a lot of fun. You're not going to want to miss them. Next Sabbath, Pastor Luke's gone, I am gone, and so we have one of my good friends named Scott Anderson. He is the Marietta campus AAA teacher. He's also the husband of one of the teachers at Carmen Avenue School, and they've recently moved to the area. He is a stellar Christian, a stellar man, a good friend of mine. He served with me as an elder in Buford, and now they're a part of this church. He's preaching next week, and I know that God's going to speak through him in a loud, powerful way, so you won't want to miss that. The following week is October 27, and it's a celebration Sabbath. I mean, we're going to have normal first and second services, but we're celebrating three things. The one-year anniversary for our We Are Capital campaign. We're celebrating phase one being completed, hopefully, prayerfully, as the parking lot slowly gets done. And we're also celebrating, what's the third thing? Let's see, parking lot phase one. I'm going to look at my notes because I forgot. Phase one. Oh, that's them. We Are phase one and then the parking lot. And here's what we're going to do after first service and second service. We'll take the congregation out into the parking lot, and we'll make a big circle, and we're going to have a dedicatory prayer over the parking lot. That sounds funny to some of you. You might be like, why are we praying over asphalt? This is dumb. No, it's not, because everything we do in our church is to be on mission to glorify God. So whether it's windows or parking lots, it's to glorify Him and to be on mission. So we're dedicating our parking lot to be on mission for Him. Here's what's cool. The next week, November 3, is Live Well Marietta. This is the point in our service where that little card that you were handed comes into play, because that card is your ticket. Not really, it's just a reminder for you to be a part of Live Well Marietta. Susan Carter and Drew Benton, who's with Project Live Love, they've been working so hard to get this organized. If you don't know what Live Well Marietta is, you've been skipping church or haven't been listening, because it's a one-day event. It's on a Sabbath. It happens in our parking lot where a couple hundred homeless are expected to come. We're cutting hair. We're doing eye checkups, Dr. Becker. We're doing dental stuff, Dr. Camp. If you haven't connected with this, I need you. We're doing health screenings. We're feeding. We're doing lots of good stuff. But you've got to register to be there. So that little card that you have, or you can look on the screen and remember it, go to projectlivelove.com/livewell and use the code MACLIVELOVE. It gets you in and the t-shirt for free. Normally it's $20, but our church said, no. We want our church to be invested in mission, and so we're going to pay your entrance. Anybody, I mean, if you're a visitor today, come on, we need you. There's your free ticket to go. So be a part of that. It's going to be fun. I think it's going to be a blessing not only to our church, but it'll be a positive influence in the local community. And with that, let's say a quick word of prayer, and let's jump into the Word. God, this morning we've had lots of music. We've had baptisms. We've had prayers. And now we're going to dig into the Word a bit. So I ask that you will speak to our hearts, encourage us, in some ways annoy us if you have to help us to understand your will for our lives. And we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. There's a part of growing up that every kid has experienced. I know exactly when it happened for me. I would suggest that probably 95% of you have experienced this in some way at some time as a kid. It is a rite of passage to becoming an adult. When I grew up, we had Wednesday evenings all to ourselves. My dad was a pastor, so he'd be at church with prayer meeting. My mom played the organ at a Methodist church, and so she would be gone as well with the choir practice and all that. And so my older sister and I would have Wednesday evenings to ourselves, home alone. It was kind of fun, and there were only three rules. The three rules were, don't let anyone in the door, be nice to each other, and make wise decisions. Now, we were great at the first two. Didn't let anybody in the door. We were nice to each other. But our decision-making skills were kind of sketchy because as soon as my parents would leave every Wednesday night, they never knew. They may not know today. I hope they're not streaming somewhere around the world right now. Every Wednesday night, as soon as my parents would leave, the TV would go on. This will date me. I understand that you younger people than me will have zero respect for me from now on. That's okay. And this is the show we would watch every Wednesday night. Here it is. Boom. Beverly Hills, 90210. Man, that guy's old. Beverly Hills, 90210. We watched the whole show, and we get the first 10 minutes of Melrose Place. Some of you remember that, so I can see some heads nodding. And we would listen with one ear to the TV and one ear for Dad and Mom's car to come home, because that TV would be off when they would get home. And oftentimes on Wednesday nights, you're kind of looking for food, you know, trying to make your own meal and whatever. And oftentimes, my sweet tooth would start bothering me. Some of you have sweet tooths. Some of you do. Some of you like savory, salty stuff, but some of you have a sweet tooth, and you know exactly what I'm talking about. When you want something sweet, you're like a cocaine addict looking for a fix, right? You will scavenge, you will hunt things, you will search for anything, and you get really, really desperate. I mean, like, I'm being vulnerable here, but that's okay, because, like, sometimes I've taken chocolate chips right out of the bag. That's not too bad. Is it bad that I've taken Swiss Miss Hot Cocoa and opened the bag and spooned that junk in there? Okay. Somebody else has done it in here. I know you have. It's really bad at Thanksgiving time, because you've got the leftovers, you got some of you turkey, some of you got mashed potatoes. And then it's really bad if you're looking in there and you're like, huh, are those candied yams? Candy sweet. And then you end up eating vegetables for your sweets. It's bad. When you have a sweet tooth, you understand this problem. Well, I remember on a Wednesday night, I was desperate for chocolate. We had nothing in the house. I'm looking everywhere. I'm looking in the pantry, I'm looking in the fridge, nothing. And so I end up looking in the cupboards, and I open this one cabinet door. It's the baking cabinet. And you know where this story's going, don't you? There's the baking powder, baking soda, there's spices, there's flour, and then I found the jackpot, the gold mine of chocolate. It was gorgeous sitting there in this little tin can, and this is what I found. Even labeled like a candy bar. 100% natural, unsweetened, that's the key word there. I mean, what kind of a sick terrorist would put something in a can that will take the trust and faith out of every child for the rest of their life? You can't trust your parents now. You'll never trust your wife or husband. I mean, this ruins it up for everybody. And there I was. I found it, pulled it down, got a spoon. And as soon as that sweet chocolate goodness touched my mouth, I had instant regret. Realizing that awful, bitter, tart, whatever you want to describe it, taste was not sweet chocolate. It was a dirty trick that somebody played on me. Instant regret. You know, I don't have any pictures or video of that day, but I did find a video of a young man named Gabriel that he has experienced this as well. See, his mother has told him many times, Gabriel, you won't want this. You will not want to eat this. Trust me. Obey me. You don't want this. And yet Gabriel desperately wants to eat this Hershey's cocoa. We got the volume up back there in the AV booth. We're good to go. Here's Gabriel and his instant regret. Here we go.
Insisting on tasting this. I keep telling him it's going to be gross, but he does not want to listen. So I'm going to let him find out for himself.
Why is it that so often we keep God at arm's length when he tries to speak into our lives, where he wants to help us and he gives us commands or instructions or encouragement or direction, and we keep him at an arm's length when he wants to speak into the well-being of our life? I mean, we'll take him when he wants to give us grace and forgiveness. Oh, you want a warm hug from the Savior? Yes! Oh, you want to change my life? Well, back it up. Why are we so stubborn when God tries to speak into our lives? Do we become disobedient? Why do we do this when he gives us instructions and we pause and we say, no, no, no? And then we wonder why we have instant regret when we discover on our own what he didn't want us to understand. This morning we're going to see a story about disobedience and about the regret that comes from it the instant regret, except in this story, it's not the disobeyer that has the regret, it's God who regrets. If you got your Bibles, I encourage you to turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 15. This story takes a whole chapter. We're definitely not reading it all. We'll just hop and jump around a little bit. 1 Samuel chapter 15, if you got your Bibles, you may want to check it out. I'll give you some context here. So you've got the nation of Israel, God's people, God's chosen people, and for a long time, they've been communicating with God through a prophet. So you've got Samuel. He's an example. He's the example in this story. He stands in between the people and God. So they talk to Samuel. Samuel talks to God. God talks to Samuel. Samuel talks to the people. So he's kind of this in-between mediator type of person. Well, the country, the nation gets ornery, and they look at all the other pagan countries around, and they say, we want to be like them. They got a king. How come we don't have a king? And so Samuel hears this, and he talks to God, and he says, what am I supposed to do about this? And so God says, here's what he says, listen to them and give them a king. Okay? God's almost like that mother where he says, all right, you want to try it? Here you go. Take a big bite of this. And so Samuel, he begins the search process for this king, and all of the nation, they're looking for this king, and he runs across this man named Saul. Here's how the Bible describes Saul. It's in 1 Samuel 9, verse 2. You don't have to look it up. Here's what it says. Saul was a young man as could be found anywhere in Israel, and he was a head taller than anyone else. Now, you know you got it going on when the Bible calls you handsome. Good-looking dude. Tall guy. And so Samuel anoints Saul and makes him king, and he's only 30 years old. Some of you are 30 or under, and he's 30 years old, and he's got great success. He's having victories, and it's during this successful time that this story happens in 1 Samuel chapter 15, and we'll start in verse 1. Here's God speaking to Saul through Samuel. Samuel said to Saul, verse 1, I am the one the Lord sent to anoint you king over his people Israel. So listen now to the message from the Lord. This is what the Lord Almighty says. I will punish the Amalekites for what they did to Israel when they waylaid them as they came up from Egypt. Now go attack the Amalekites and totally destroy all that belongs to them. Do not spare them. Put to death men and women, children and infants, cattle and sheep, camels and donkeys. I mean, God gets very, very specific in his orders to annihilate the Amalekites. And I think for some of us, as we read this just in its raw wording, it puts a bad taste in our mouth about who God is. Who is this vengeful God that wants to kill infants? And yet, I think of the God that I know and love, and he's the God that is long-suffering, that's full of mercy, and yet he's also full of justice to those that refuse to obey his commands. In fact, these Amalekites, they are a raiding band. Not necessarily massive cities, but they would go around and they'd pick on the little guys, or they'd prey on the guys that weren't paying attention. They'd steal and kill and whatever. And so they just hop around. And at one point, as Moses is leading the Israelites, the Amalekites come and they attack Israel. And God says, hey, I've given these people chance after chance. It's time to destroy, annihilate them. In fact, the wording that God uses is kind of interesting. The Hebrew word he uses is haram, meaning to destroy, to devote to death, to exterminate. Sounds a bit harsh, doesn't it? You know, our church, we have an exterminator. He's the bug man. I don't remember his name. I think his name is Bob. He's a cool dude. I see him every month. He comes. He's a jolly fella. He's got theology training, and he's actively working to become a pastor in a church somewhere. And we've prayed together. We've talked quite a bit. He's a nice guy. He comes every month and sprays for rodents and pests. Sometimes, almost every time, he goes out to this walkway, and you'll see it as you walk out, and you'll see the trail of ants that goes up and into the walkway there. We're going to have to do something about that one day. And not too long ago, about a month ago, we had some visitors to our church, and they weren't humans. They were snakes. We had, yeah, y'all are panicked. Some of you are like, oh, put my feet on the pew. A few snakes down in the gym. There was one snake in by the school. And so we did something about it. We called our exterminators. Say, hey, we're getting rid of them. We got to do something about this. This is a problem. We don't know what kind of snakes they are, but instantly you go to like, oh, man, it was a black mamba. I saw it. King Cobra sliding around in Marietta, Georgia. We got to get rid of these. And so the exterminator came, and he cast these granules, these sweet smelling, it smells like essential oils, kind of. Cast them out, these granules, all around the perimeter of the church and the school, the gym and the ball field. And it's this sweet smelling stuff. And I said, Bob, what is this stuff? And he said, this is snake deterrent. They will smell it, and they know that they don't want to be there. So they go the other way. It's a warning for them. It's saying, hey, if you come any closer, you're going to have trouble. And I think that if those snakes ignored the snake deterrent, the warnings, if they continued to come in here, there would be two females. One works in our office here in the church. The other one's the principal of the school. That would be on attack mode to any snake around here. I mean, I see machetes, high heels, it doesn't matter. Getting rid of the snakes. And at some level, in a very weird sort of way, I think this kind of describes the situation with the Amalekites, where God has continually warned them and said, hey, I want you to be part of my people. I want you to accept me as your God. But if you won't, then judgment will happen. If you choose to disobey and dishonor me, then judgment comes. And that's what's happened. As God gives specific instructions, he says there, totally destroy all that belongs to them. Everything. Exterminate them. So those are the orders. Here's Saul as he carries them out. Verse 4. So Saul summoned the men and mustered them at Telaim. 200,000 foot soldiers and 10,000 from Judah. Saul went to the city of Amalek and set an ambush in the ravine. Then he said to the Kenites, go away, leave the Amalekites so that I do not destroy you along with them. For you showed kindness to all the Israelites when they came up out of Egypt. So the Kenites moved away from the Amalekites. This Kenite group of people, they are some distant relative of the Israelites. You know, there was like a second cousin twice removed of the stepbrother of the cousin of the aunt of Moses or something like that. Some weird connection, but they showed favor to the Israelites. And so Saul said, hey, you're not with the Amalekites, and if you want to live, you need to leave. And so the Kenites move. So here's what happens in verse 7 through 9. Here's the actual what happened. Then Saul attacked the Amalekites all the way from Havilah to Shur, near the eastern border of Egypt. He took Agag, king of the Amalekites, alive. And all his people he totally destroyed with the sword. But Saul and the army spared Agag and the best of the sheep and cattle, the fat calves and lambs, everything that was good. These they were unwilling to destroy completely, but everything that was despised and weak was totally destroyed. So as you read about Saul and he does his war here, let me ask you this question. Did Saul obey? Any yeses out there? Okay. I mean, he partially obeyed, didn't he? He destroyed most of the Amalekites. He exterminated most of the animals. He mostly obeyed, right? Doesn't that count? And it brings me to a point in this message that it spoke to me this last week, and I hope it speaks into your life too. It's simply this. Mostly obeying is the same as disobeying. Did you hear it? Mostly obeying is the same as disobeying. I mean, so often we half-heartedly obey God. We obey him only part of the way. And as I was putting these applications that you're about to hear together on Thursday morning as I was writing this, I thought, boy, this really applies to my life. And it points out areas in my life where I might only be partly obeying. So see if the shoe fits for you too, where you can maybe tweak some things in your life so you fall into obedience rather than mostly obedience. How about this? We tell the truth most of the time, but we will happily walk the line when we make returns at the clothing store. Is it new? Oh, yes, it's like new. How about this one? We don't steal most of the time unless it's going to benefit us and no one will know. We don't get angry most of the time unless it's under our breath or just in our heads. We don't curse most of the time unless it's out of frustration. That should be okay, right? Or when we vegetize the words and just use slang curse words. We don't hate. No, no, no. Most of the time, unless other people are hating alongside us. We don't break the Sabbath most of the time, unless our favorite sports team is playing. We don't hold back forgiveness, no, most of the time, unless the other person won't forgive first. I mean, we're happy to obey when it doesn't take work and effort and doesn't hurt, or when it helps us in some way. We're happy to obey, but God asks for total obedience, not partial, not mostly obedience. He calls for full-on, total, committed obedience. In fact, throughout the whole Bible, you can see it time after time as God's calling his people to obey in completeness. In Exodus, he's just about to give the Ten Commandments to his chosen people. And here's what he says. Exodus 19, he says, "Now if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession." I mean, that's powerful. He says, if you obey me to the max, completely, not partially, not mostly, but all the way, you'll be my treasured possession. He talks about it in Revelation as he's talking about this end time remnant movement, this group of people that honor him. He describes them like this. This calls for the patient endurance on part of the people of God who keep his commandments and remain faithful to Jesus. Keep it all, everything all together to remain faithful to him. He really summarizes it in John chapter 14. He says this, "If you love me, keep my commandments." All of them, all together. And what's incredibly clear throughout the Bible is that God's desire is for us to give him full obedience in every aspect of our life. And I don't think that it's because he's a demanding God. I think it's because he has our best interest in mind. And when we follow him and obey his commands and his laws and his insight into our life, when we listen to him, we are the best that we can be. We're the healthiest, we're the wealthiest, we're the happiest that we can be when we follow God. But for some reason, we want to pick and choose the areas where we want to obey. All of us, everybody, me included. And if that's where you find yourself right now, walking the line between obedience and disobedience, maybe this next part of Saul's story will encourage you. And I don't think encourage like, oh, that's great what Saul did. Encouragement like, ooh, look what he did. I don't want to be like that. Make sense? Here's the rest. God sees Saul's partial obedience, and here's his response in verse 10. "Then the word of the Lord came to Samuel, 'I regret that I've made Saul king.'" That's instant regret. Saul, the people have asked for a king, let's give him Saul, and I regret my decision to have him be king. That's what he said. Verse 11, "I regret that I've made Saul king because he's turned away from me and has not carried out my instructions." Because he disobeyed God, God regretted having Saul be king. Story goes on. Samuel goes to Saul and he has a fierce conversation with him. He talks about, "Hey, so how did the battle go?" And Saul says, "Oh, it was awesome. It was great." Samuel says, "Did you kill them all?" Yeah, we did. "And even look, I have a trophy here." Ellen White talks about how Saul kept King Agag alive so that he could be a living trophy of the victory of who Saul was. Almost like the people could see, "Hey, look at me. I got the whole group, all the Amalekites. I even have their king right here." That's not obeying. Samuel keeps going. He says, "Well, did you kill all the animals?" And Samuel says, "Oh, yeah, sure." Or Saul says, "Yeah, sure." And Samuel says, "Oh, what's the bleating of sheep that I hear? What's that?" And so you can hear Saul as he's backtracking, as he's being defensive, as he's trying to make excuses. He says, oh, the sheep, yeah. All the army guys, all the people, they are the ones that said we should keep them. Because you know why we're keeping them? We want to keep the best so we can make an offering to God. It'll be a sacrifice to him. We want to bring these animals and we can sacrifice. It'll be our worship to him. And it's then that Samuel says these words. This is the reply in verse 22. Samuel replied to Saul. I'll put it on the screen for you too. "Does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice." And I think you could put a lot of different words in the place of sacrifice. To obey is better than your church attendance. To obey is better than how much you put in a tithe or giving envelope. To obey is better than a lot of different things. He says, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams. God's regret came from Saul's mostly obeying. And because he hadn't obeyed all the way, he had disobeyed, and God regretted having him be king. And I would leave this sermon here, except it's so negative. You go home and you start crying. We're not going to leave it negative. I want to leave it very encouraging. But you can't get it from the life of Saul, at least not in this passage. But I want to give it to you in the life of a couple that's here in our church that I'm going to introduce to you here in a minute. In fact, I'm going to bring them up in just a minute. You may not know them. They're probably freaking out right now. Oh, is this the time? He told us about this. Do we go up now? I don't know. Just wait. You guys are good. There's a couple in our church named Abby and Amari. They're, how old are you guys? 20? 20? 22? 20, 22? They're young. I mean, there's a lot of young adults in here. And they've been to our church for probably, I don't know, 4, 5, 6 months probably. Maybe even longer than that. So here's their story, and I'll bring you up at the very end, so you guys just relax. Here's their story, at least the way Amari was telling me this morning. So they've had a Christian experience, and yet at one point, maybe 6 months ago, Amari's godfather shared with him the joy of Sabbath, explained to him what it was, what the seventh day Sabbath is, this day that God reserves as a day for us to commune with him, a day to spend time with him, to get to know him, a day to focus on him. And so Amari and Abby said, I want to fully obey in my life. I want to do whatever it takes to honor God and obey him. And so they felt this calling to obey him. And so they show up at our church. And honestly, it took me a long time before I connected with you guys or even, you know, said, I mean, I'm not shaking your hand at the back door. Hey, guys, good to see you again. Glad you've been here for 10 years, you know, whatever. And it took me a while. Finally, we connected a little bit. They're in the fundamentals class. They're going through that stuff to understand God's completeness, who God is in all aspects. But here's what I love about them. They're continually trying to honor God and obey him in every piece of their life. I'll give you two examples. Maybe about a month ago, after church one day, I get a phone call from Amari. And he says, Pastor Matt, Abby and I are going to go on a trip. And we just printed out the directions. Is it a sin to print on Sabbath? And I giggled a little bit on the phone. I don't know. Maybe you didn't hear me go, ha, 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 ha. But in my mind, I giggled. It sounded just like that, ha, ha, ha. And I said, I giggled for two reasons. Here's what it was. That's not really a giggle, is it? It's more of a scary Santa Claus laugh. I think that's what it is. Giggled. Yeah. So I giggled for two reasons. One, because it was fun to explain to you in a very short way how Sabbath isn't a burden with these restrictions on what you can and can't do on Sabbath, but it's a joy so that you, if it fits in line with, does this help me know Jesus better? You do it. And if it doesn't fit in that, then maybe you shouldn't do it. And how printing a piece of paper is not the concept of Sabbath. It's this joyous day that we get to spend with him. So that, and the other reason is that I giggled like a Santa Claus, angry Santa Claus, was because you guys were growing in your spiritual life where you were saying, I want to obey him totally. Second story. Last Sabbath at the church retreat, Abby and Amari come. Abby goes on this incredibly long hike out in the woods, gets lost for hours. And Amari's hanging out with me a little bit. And he said, Pastor Matt, I've been doing some studying, doing some research. I've been watching some YouTube videos on what clean and unclean meats are. Like, help me understand that. And so we talked for a few minutes, and I got to share, hey, man, here's what that's about. Our bodies are God's temple. He lives inside our hearts and our minds. So because it's his place of residence, we want this to be a healthy body, an earthly temple, kind of, for him to live in. So there's clean and unclean meats, and God asks you to not eat unclean meats and says you can eat clean meats. But it goes way beyond meat. It's sugars included. You with sweet tooths like me? Sweet teeth like me? Sweet tooths? Yeah, whatever. It goes beyond that. Exercise. It goes up beyond that. Like what you eat and drink and everything that you do with your body. It's all inclusive. And it's so fun to watch Amari and Abby grow in their walk. And here's the thing is I know that there are lots of people in here today that have felt God move in your life to encourage you to obey in all aspects of life. Not just what you think you should do, but what you know that God asks and commands you to do. So here's what I'm going to do. This may feel awkward for some, and I'm just going to throw it out there. I kind of was thinking this morning, should I do this, should I not? Here's what I'm going to do. This morning, this isn't an altar call like give your life to Jesus, but I'm going to invite definitely Abby and Amara. You guys can come up. You'll be the first. If there are those this morning that have felt God calling, here, this is our awesome couple. If you don't know them, get to know them. They're awesome. Yay. We're gonna walk down here on the floor, and I'm gonna invite any of you that feel God is calling you to obey completely in aspects of your life. You're the only one that's gonna know, you and God. Nobody else is. But if you feel his calling and moving in your life to honor him and obey him in completeness in certain ways, I want you to come to the front and we're gonna pray. In fact, I'll invite you guys to come down here. So if you want a special prayer over you, you can come. If not, I'm just gonna pray for these two. But you guys can come. This is the time to come. I see you. All right, you're coming. This is just prayer time, a little garden of prayer for those that feel like you need some extra prayer in obeying him. Yep, it's cool. Welcome, come on down, squeeze in here. We got a lot. See, if I'd called for baptism, this would be, oh, y'all would be sitting, nobody moving at all. I know how it works. That's cool. All right. This is more than I thought. That's fine. Good. And if you don't want to come up, I'll pray for you too in your seat. Let me pray for you now. Heavenly Father, it's cool to see so many people that feel you moving in their hearts to help them obey completely in some area in their life. And so I ask that you will encourage them, help them to make adjustments, help them to see your clear picture for how you'd like them to live. I pray a special prayer for Abby and Amari as they continue their journey with you. May they continue to grow and understand you in your fullness and in your completeness. And God, we love how you're moving in this church, and we love you. And can't wait to see you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You can go back to your seats.